Okay, this morning's prayer is being whole again. Lord, look after your righteous ones standing with those who put their hope in and trust in you. Though they are attacked, you will rescue them and set them at your right hand. I put my hope in your great promises and seek your will in the earth. Stand with me and with my wingman, and I will be restored. You repair what has been broken. Your heart dwells with those who are distraught and those who have been victims of this world. Amen.
Praise God. I'm asking that everyone would please stand for a moment of prayer. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, we give you praise and we magnify and glorify your name on this day. For this is the day that you have made, and we shall continue to rejoice and be glad in it. Yes. We thank you, Father God, for an opportunity to come to the throne, Father God, and give you praise and thanksgiving. Hallelujah. For who you are and how you've kept us, Father God. Yes. For the promises that you've given us, a yea and amen. Yes. We thank you, Father God, for another opportunity to sit under our pastor's feet, Father God, and hear your word that you downloaded in her, Father God, for our comfort, for our instruction, Father God, for our correction. We thank and praise you for that. We thank and praise you for Chabot, L.A. Chabot, Four Square Church, Father God. We praise you for the ministry and for the mission, Father God. We praise you for Pastor Johnson and Pastor Woods, Father God. Women of God that you set as shepherds over this place, Father God. We thank you for the word that's in them. We thank you for the love that's in them. We thank you, Father God, they are hearers and doers of the word, Father God. We thank you for the dreams and visions that you've given them, Father God. We thank you for them mentoring us, Father God, that we can be ambassadors, Father God, in Jesus' name. We thank you we're the church on the hill, Father God, whose light never goes out, Father God. We thank you right now, Father God, for the members of L.A. Chabot, the family, the business, the listeners, Father God, we thank you for them. Bless them, Father God, in every area of their life where they need blessings, Father God. We thank you for our tithers. We thank you for our givers, Father God. We thank you for the word that goes forth, Father God. We thank you this is a teaching church, Father God, in Jesus' name. If you want to know the word, if you want to know about the gift, Father God, this is the place for me. We thank you, Father God, for the love that's in this place. When you walk through the door, Father God, there is love going out, Father God. We love each one here, Father God. We thank and praise you right now, Father God, for the services today, Father God, that you will be high and lifted up, Father God, in Jesus' name, and that your train, your glory, will fill this temple, Father God, and we give you praise for that right now in Jesus' name. Amen, and thank God. For the scripture reading today, I'm calling your attention to Joshua, the first chapter, beginning at verse 7 through 9. Joshua 1, verses 7 through 9. Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid nor dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Amen. We praise God for his word, for the doers and the hearers. Amen.
We give you praise.
Hallelujah.
We give you praise.
For now and always.
Lord, we give you praise. We give you praise.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
We give you praise.
Lord, now and always.
Lord, now and always. We give you praise.
We give you praise. Hallelujah. Now and always,
Lord, now and always, we give you praise.
We give you,
we give you praise.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
We give you praise.
But now and always.
Lord, now and always. We give you praise. We give you,
we give you praise. Hallelujah.
We give you praise.
Lord, now and always.
Lord, now and always.
Lord, now.
Lord, now and always.
Lord.
Lord, now and always. We give.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He's worthy, worthy, worthy.
Hallelujah. 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 We give you praise. We exalt you, Lord. Lord, now
hallelujah.
And always. Lord, now and always. Lord, now and always. We
Lord, now. worthy, 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 worthy,
worthy, worthy, worthy, worthy, worthy, worthy, worthy, worthy, worthy, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
I am a Christian. Do you know what that means? That means I'm far from perfect, simply redeemed, bought with a purpose, purchased by love. It's not a form of religion, but a gift from above. I am not perfect, no, but I have been redeemed. I am a believer. Do you know what that means? That means I've pledged my life, giving everything. I never knew that this was meant to be. I'm not perfect, but I have been redeemed. While I was yet in my transgression, somebody paid the price for me. I offer up my life to him, and now I say again, I am not perfect, no, but I've been redeemed.
Hallelujah.
I am your sister. Let me show you the way. We'll take this road together. Oh, take it day by day. I know somehow that this was meant to be. Make no mistake about it. You have been redeemed. While you were yet in your transgression, somebody paid to set you free. So when I give your life to him, accept his love and will begin to walk together, for we have been redeemed, redeemed. Oh, you were yet in our transgression, he gave his life for you and me. So when I give your life to him, accept his love and then begin to walk together hand in hand, and surely he will heal our land, and we will these chains no more, as these walls crashing to the floor. And then someday he'll come again, and we will in him, then we'll be perfect. We will be perfect. We will be perfect. Oh, yes, we will. We will be perfect. Oh, yes, we will. Simply redeemed.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes.
I have friends. I have friends. I'm so happy to see each one of you this morning. And I have friends that tell me our announcements are not effective. And after hearing that, I wanted to know what to do. So I was told that it might be helpful to have like the Foursquare conference written up in paper form where people could see the dates, the sign up, and information like that. And I don't know how to do that. I preach and I tell jokes and I love, you know. Okay, so I'm gonna throw it back out here. Who could help us with this? Because I'm told our announcements are not effective. When Jesse or anybody else gets up, I heard that people shut down, they don't hear, they don't know what's said. So it needs to be in written form. Now we have had, for volumes of years, a bulletin that would have things in it. And they would be left on the floor on the chair, and then people would call and ask me questions about what's happening. And then it became more interesting when the people that were making the announcements would tell me they didn't know, and they were reading it. Family, it's a problem. It's a problem. I know that announcements can be heard and not go over people's heads, where I hear later, well, I didn't know, I didn't hear. Well, the announcements go over my head. But I need you. We're a family. I need you to help me. Who's going to type it up? Is that going to do it? We're going to go back to bulletins again for them to just be left, and you still don't know what's happening? I don't know what to do. So I'm giving it to you. Let's pray in about 30 seconds in tongues. Father, please give us remedy in Jesus' name. Lord, communication is important. We want effective communication, Lord. How can it be done where everybody knows what's happening? Thank you, Lord. Bring remedy, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. I want to share something I don't believe I've shared before. I want to share it because it came to me to share this morning, so I'm going to share. I want to share how I met Dr. Suheda, Dr. Charles Suheda. I don't even think I told him this. In 85, we bought a church on Dinker and 103rd Street, and I decided that I was going to do like other pastors, and I was going to stay home on Mondays. Mondays are supposed to be pastor's day off. So I made this declaration, and I was awakened early that morning by the Lord telling me, hurry up and go to church. I want to talk to you. So I realized he couldn't talk to me at home. What's going on, you know? So I showered and dressed and went to church. Nobody's there. I went into my office. But it was kind of scary because I didn't know why he couldn't talk to me there at home. You know, then I said, well, is he coming? Is he going to knock on the door? You know, I had all these questions, you know. However, the day before, my real estate agent, some of you remember Barbara Ellis, had asked me to go with her to a meeting at the Cockatoo Inn, which is torn down now. That was so long ago, 85. And she said a friend of hers from Texas had come in to run a revival, and she wanted me to meet this prophet. So I went, and it was uneventful, and I you know, it was a word, and I praised the Lord, and I came home. But then Monday morning, I went in there, and I was I was in my office maybe 2 minutes, and there was a knock at the door. It was 8 in the morning, about 5 after 8 in the morning. Then I said, is he knocking? You know what? And I said, okay. So I opened the door, and it was that lady that ran the revival. She said, my sister told me this is your church. She said, and God told me to cancel. She said, we were on the way to the airport from the hotel, and God told me to cancel that trip and get a later trip and talk to you. He has some things he wanted to say. I said, oh, okay. So she came in, and she began to tell me some things that did not agree with my spirit at all, at all, at all. They didn't make no sense to me, and it was so much not like me. And the last thing she told me is, she said, I want to tell you about a man that God's going to send into your life later, and he's going to be a support. And she began to talk about this, and then she described him. But before that, she described another man that God was going to send. And that was Monday. Tuesday night, the Holy Spirit sent that man. Okay. So years passed, and I wondered about this other man. And one day I went to a meeting. I think it was a 3 or 4 day meeting about mental health. And I was walking down the hall, and everybody was going in one direction. It was like traffic, you know, your shoulder to shoulder. And I saw a man's head kind of sticking above the height of the rest. And Lulu decided she was going to bother that man. Some of you don't know her, but you don't need to meet her. Anyway, I couldn't catch up with him, because we were shoulder to shoulder, and he was maybe 5 people ahead of me. So I started singing. And you know I'm under contract not to sing. So people wanted to know who had the nerve, you know. They turned around and looked. And when they turned, I scooted through them, you know. And then I acted nice. And I don't know what I said to Dr. Sahada, but I gave him my card, because I know how God uses me in connections, okay? So I didn't see him anymore for years. And then he ended up at the church one day. But I knew he was this description that somebody had given me some 15 years prior. And that's what he's been, a friend and a support. It's been beautiful. Do you all listen to God? Don't miss your cues. Come on, Dr. Sahada, give us the word.
All right. Thanks. Thank you. By the way, I still have your business card. It's the way it is. Right, I heard some people at Hollywood Press started coming down here. That's how I heard about it, yeah. So, you know, I do devotionals every day, as I know many of you do too, daily devotionals. And I have a little devotional book now that is, thank you, Randall. It's, you read Psalms every day and you read Proverbs every day. And that's something new for me. I mean, it's a different type of devotional. So whatever devotional book you use, wonderful. That's really wonderful. So I started reading Proverbs, and I was very, very impressed, especially by the beginning. Now, if you've ever read a nonfiction book, then you'll know that generally the author tells you what the purpose of the book is. They either have a preface or they have an introduction, so you know right away what's their point. And then a lot of times they'll even tell you what's in the chapters. So today, what I'd like to speak a little bit about Proverbs, and I want to also do integration. So Proverbs, in a certain sense, it's contained in the book itself, but there's admonitions and demonstrations in other parts of the Bible. And I just have one question for you today. Can you name a very important New Testament proverb? There is one in the New Testament. We all know it. It's in the back of your mind, on the tip of your tongue. I don't know if you remember. Anybody? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Now, remember that we do have proverbs in our culture. We've heard it before: a stitch in time saves nine, a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush, all those kinds of things. But those are practical things. They don't have anything to do with God. They don't have anything to do with religion, and they have nothing to do with our faith. Now, right away, the author identifies himself as Solomon, the son of David, the king of Israel. And one of the things that we need to know about Solomon is that the Lord, remember, if you remember from your Bible, the Lord appeared to him in a dream. I can tell you where that is. That's in 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 6, and from there on. And God said to him in the dream, "Ask me for anything, I'll give you anything you ask me for." And what did he ask for? He didn't ask for riches. He didn't ask for land. He asked for wisdom to rule the people. And so God gave him that wisdom to rule the people. He said, "But I'm going to give you more than what you asked for." So number one, he asked for it. You can hear the echo of that in James also, right? If anyone lacks wisdom, ask the Lord. The Lord will give them wisdom liberally. But I just want to look at the first seven verses right here. So generally what I do is I try to, sometimes I only use a couple of verses, but in this case I think this is really important, so I'm going to read the seven verses, starting with two. To know wisdom and instruction, to discern the sayings of understanding, to receive instruction in wise behavior, righteousness, justice, and equity. Now let's stop right there. Do you remember when Abraham was bargaining with God about Sodom and Gomorrah? What was he bargaining about? The number of righteous people. And so there were not even five righteous people in that area. And so what did the Lord tell Abraham? One of the most important verses: teach your children and your descendants righteousness. Okay, it is a theme that goes throughout much of the Bible. Okay, and it says, verse 4, to give prudence to the naive. Okay, so prudence means to be able to use reason to live well and to make good decisions, to live a disciplined life. Okay, so who are the naive? The people who are not aware of wisdom, the people who live unwise lives. They're not stupid people. They're not people who are incapable of knowing, but they just don't know. So the question is, who is this good for? Who is this book good for? It says, number one, to the naive, the person who doesn't know. Number two, to the youth. Number three, to the man, to the wise man. Okay, so the person already thinks he's wise, okay? Number four, to the man or the woman who has understanding. So they went, you know, they acquired a lot of life experience. They have a lot of knowledge, you know, they're resourceful people, and God says, look, that's still not enough. There's more than you need, and so that's the point of Proverbs. So let me give you a demonstration of that right now, and that is that if you don't need to go to Daniel, but it's in Daniel chapter 2, one of the most interesting and unique chapters in the Bible, and that is that, if you remember, Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, and the dream was very disturbing, and so he woke up, but he forgot the dream, and so he got all of his counselors and wise people in the court, and he said, guess what, I want you to tell me the dream, and I want you to interpret it for me. And of course Daniel was also part of that, and the mandate was, if you can't tell me these things, everybody dies. So what did Daniel do? Daniel prayed to the Lord and beseeched God, and he got the answer. And then his prayer, verse 19 through 23, He said the mystery was real to Daniel, not a vision. Then Daniel blessed the Lord of heaven. And let the name of God be blessed forever and ever, for wisdom and power belong to him. He's the one who changes times and epochs, removes the rulers, essentially, and he establishes rulers. He gives wisdom to wise men and knowledge to men of understanding. Now, look, let me mention one thing. I'm telling you that that's a demonstration. And if you think about this particular verse, what one thing that comes to mind is that where the knowledge and wisdom of man ends, the knowledge and wisdom of God begins. This account, I mean, if somebody tells you they lost something, but they don't know what they lost, and they don't know where they lost it, how are you ever going to find it? You're not. So it's a demonstration of God's wisdom and knowledge. So that's why I said it's a demonstration. So again, in verse 5, it says, even the wise person will hear, if you read, if you learn, and you will increase in learning. And the man and the person who has understanding will acquire wise counsel. To understand a proverb and a figure, the words of the wise and their riddles. And then we've all heard this, verse 7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. So basically, it categorizes people. Those who open their ears and listen, those who open their eyes and read, those whose hearts are open and they want to follow what the Word of God says, those people will revere the Lord. And if they do that, then they'll increase in knowledge and wisdom. So that's the very beginning of that. Now, let me just... Okay, so I'm trying to demonstrate for you right now the purpose and the value of Proverbs, because we all have our favorite places that we go to in the book. We like this proverb, we like that proverb. But this basically is an overview. It's a really important overview. And in the first four chapters, the main themes are, number one is to revere God. When it says fear, it doesn't mean get scared and run and hide somewhere. Fear simply means that reverence, and it's something that we truly lack today. There's very little respect or reverence for anybody in our society anymore. Number two is to know God. Number three is to trust God. That'd be the third chapter. And number four is to hear God, because the Lord speaks through. If we believe that the Word of God is inspired, then we know that it's the voice of the Spirit speaking. Now, if I go to chapter two, there, I'm not going to read the whole chapter, but starting at verse 3, because I have a point to make here. For if you cry for discernment, and you lift your voice for understanding, if you seek her as silver and search for her as for hidden treasure, then you will discern the fear of the Lord and discover the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom from his mouth. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. So I have to be motivated to pursue this. We need motivation. It's really important. It's not going to read itself. You have to read it for yourself. Now, I want to show an admonition in Jeremiah, which all of you are familiar with, the 29th chapter of Jeremiah. If you look at verse 13, he says, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart, and I will be found by you, declares the Lord. And I will restore your fortunes, and I'll gather you from the nations, etc. So there's something we have to do, even though we know that it's the Lord who pursues us. But at the same time, we have to pursue the Lord. So that's not contradictory at all. That's just the way it is. Now, I want to go to the chapter 3. And I want to give you a little personal testimony here. Many years ago, I was leaving a job, and they pretty much said goodbye and good luck. And I was up in Pasadena, and as I got in my car, I was driving over to Pete's. You probably know Pete's Coffee. And this verse came to mind. Verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding.
in all your ways acknowledge him. And he will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Thank you. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. I'm driving, this verse came to my mind. I didn't know what was going to happen. Because, look, we all face these kind of situations. We all face the unknown. Lord, remind me of that. A couple of weeks later, maybe a month later, I got a call from somebody at the VA. And they said, would you like to interview for a job? I said, sure. I went over, met the people, filled out the application, I got the job. So here's what I did. I printed out this verse, an 8.5 by 11 piece of paper. I put it on a piece of cardboard and I put it on my desk. Every person that came to my office saw that. My intention was it was gonna help people, because you know, when you're dealing with the VA or you're dealing with any bureaucracy, it's hard to know which path to take. And by the way, it's not path singular, it's paths plural, which makes ever. So whatever aspect of life you need help with. So God is not only the God of the spiritual part of our being, he's the God of all of our entire being. And we need to remember that. So my intention was it was gonna help people and give them hope. And so when it was time for me to leave, my case manager came in and he said, I'd like to ask you something. I said, okay, go ahead. He said, I'd like to have that verse that's on your desk. I said, sure. So I went and he put it on his own desk, continued working there. It was actually, it was the Haven over in at the VA property. But anyway, I just wanted to mention that because it's one of the most important verses of my life. I never thought it would come around to me, but right now, as I'm in recovery, it's not my life verse, but it's a very important verse to my life. Because you have to deal with so many different people. You have to deal with the medical people, the insurance people, even people who, just general people ask you what are you up to, what are you doing? And so you have to try to be a witness to them and motivate them and encourage them and that type of thing. So this particular verse is possibly one of my favorite verses from the Old Testament. So the only other thing I want to mention, going back to Jeremiah 29, in verse 11, he says, for I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope. Okay. And by the way, I just want to say that's the second one I use with the veterans. And they loved it because a lot of them were Vietnam vets and they were still dealing with the VA, trying to get their cases settled. So you can imagine after 20, 25 years or more, they're trying to settle their cases and it's very difficult. But I would just say to you today that if you're facing roadblocks, you're facing the unknown, number one, Proverbs tells us that God has the answer. It may be a complicated answer, it may be a simple answer, it may be something that's just right there out in the open, but we just don't understand what it is. So that's really important. He has an answer for you. And it says, do not be wise in your own eyes. So we need to be humble. We need to acknowledge who God is. Remember that you're not the master and commander of your life. I'm not the master and commander of my life, even though there was a movie, I think years ago, called Master and Commander. If somebody says that to you or says that you're in control of your life, well, you're responsible. I'm responsible for my life, And there's a limited amount of control that we have, or self-control and discipline. But ultimately, it's the Lord who's sovereign. We need to remember that, sovereign over things. So
take courage. We have people here today that are facing challenges. Yeah, trust in the Lord, and he will acknowledge him with just talk frankly, and he will make your path straight and help you through. Okay. All right. God bless you.